You're listening to the audio production of No Wonder They Call Him the Savior by Max Lucado, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Ben Holland.
Introduction. The Brazilians taught me the beauty of a blessing. Here is a scene repeated in Brazil thousands of times daily. It's early morning, time for young Marcos to leave for school. As he gathers his books and heads for the door, he pauses by his father's chair. He searches his father's face. Blessing, Father? The father raises his hand. God bless you, my son. Marco smiles and hurries out the door. This scene came to mind as I thought about the re-release of No Wonder They Call Him the Savior. I wrote this book in Brazil. My years in Rio de Janeiro gave birth to many of these thoughts. The church we served was young, so were we, and hungry for the cross. We were too. Many of my messages centered around the Savior. May God bless you as you listen to them. Just as the Brazilian children seek blessings from their fathers, so may you seek His. He'll give it, you know. He always has. That's why we call Him Father. The Part That Matters. I just want to know what counts. Deep Irish brogue, dark, deep eyes. The statement was sincere. Don't talk to me of religion. I've been down that road. And please stay off theology. I have a degree in that. Get to the heart of it, okay? I want to know what counts. His name was Ian. He was a student at a Canadian university where I was visiting. Through a series of events, he found out I was a Christian, and I found out he wanted to be but was disenchanted. I grew up in the church, he explained. I wanted to go into the ministry. I took all the courses, the theology, the languages, the exegesis. But I quit. Something just didn't click. It's in there somewhere, he spoke with earnestness. At least, I think it is. I looked up from my coffee as he began to stir his. Then he summarized his frustration with one question. What really matters? What counts? Tell me. Skip the periphery, go to the essence. Tell me the part that matters. The part that matters. I looked at Ian for a long time. The question hung in the air. What should I have said? What could I have said? I could have told him about church. I could have given him a doctrinal answer or read him something classic like the 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd." But all that seemed too small. Maybe some thoughts on sexuality or prayer or the golden rule. No. Ian wanted the treasure. He wanted the meat. Stop and empathize for a second. Can you hear his question? Can you taste his frustration? Don't give me religion, he was saying. Give me what matters. What does matter? In your Bible of over 1,000 pages, what matters? Among all the do's and don'ts and shoulds and shouldn'ts, what is essential? What is indispensable? The Old Testament? The New? Grace? Baptism? What would you have said to Ian? Would you have spoken on the evil of the world or maybe the imminence of heaven? Would you have quoted John 3:16 or Acts 2:38 or maybe read 1 Corinthians 13? What really matters? You've probably wrestled with this question. Maybe you've gone through the acts of religion and faith and yet found yourself more often than not at a dry well. Prayers seem empty. Goals seem unthinkable. Christianity becomes a warped record full of highs and lows and off-key notes. Is this all there is? Sunday attendance, pretty songs, faithful tithings, golden crosses, three-piece suits, big choirs, leather Bibles. It is nice and all, but where is the heart of it? I stirred my coffee. Ian stirred his. I had no answer. All my verses so obediently memorized seemed inappropriate. All my canned responses seemed timid. Yet now, years later, I know what I would share with him. Think about these words from Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures. First importance, he says. There's more. Listen. That he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. There it is. Almost too simple. Jesus was killed, buried, and resurrected. Surprised? The part that matters is the cross. No more and no less. The cross. It rests on the timeline of history like a compelling diamond. Its tragedy summons all sufferers. Its absurdity attracts all cynics. Its hope lures all searchers. And according to Paul, the cross is what counts. My, what a piece of wood. History has idolized it and despised it, gold-plated it and burned it, worn it and trashed it. History has done everything to it but ignore it. That's the one option that the cross does not offer. No one can ignore it. You can't ignore a piece of lumber that suspends the greatest claim in history. A crucified carpenter claiming that he is God on earth? Divine? Eternal? The death slayer? No wonder Paul called it the core of the gospel. Its bottom line is sobering. If the account is true, it is history's hinge, period. If not, it is history's hoax. That's why the cross is what matters. That's why, if I had that cup of coffee to drink with Ian again, I would tell him about it. I'd tell of the drama on that windy April day, the day when the kingdom of death was repossessed and hope took up the payments. I'd tell of Peter's tumble, Pilate's hesitancy, and John's loyalty. We'd read about the foggy garden of decision and the incandescent room of the resurrection. We discussed the final words uttered so deliberately by the self-sacrificing Messiah. And finally, we'd look at the Messiah himself, a blue-collar Jew whose claim altered a world and whose promise has never been equaled. No wonder they call him the Savior. I'm wondering if I might not be addressing some readers who have the same question that Ian had. Oh, the cross is nothing new to you. You have seen it. You have worn it. You have thought about it. You have read about it. Maybe you have even prayed to it. But do you know it? Any serious study of the Christian claim is, at its essence, a study of the cross. To accept or reject Christ without a careful examination of Calvary is like deciding on a car without looking at the engine. Being religious without knowing the cross is like owning a Mercedes with no motor. Pretty package, but where is your power? Will you do me a favor? Get yourself some coffee, get comfortable, and give me an hour of your time. Take a good look at the cross with me. Let's examine this hour in history. Let's look at the witnesses. Let's listen to the voices. Let's watch the faces. And most of all, let's observe the one they call the Savior. And let's see if we can find the part that matters. Part 1. The Cross. Its Words. Chapter 1. Final Words, Final Acts. In a recent trip to my hometown, I took some time to go see a tree. A live oak tree, my dad had called it, with the accent on live. It was nothing more than a sapling, so thin I could wrap my hand around it and touch my middle finger to my thumb. The West Texas wind scattered the fall leaves and caused me to zip up my coat. There is nothing colder than a prairie wind, especially in a cemetery. A special tree, I said to myself, with a special job. I looked around. The cemetery was lined with elms, but no oaks. The ground was dotted with tombstones, but no trees. Just this one. A special tree for a special man. About 3 years ago, Daddy began noticing a steady weakening of his muscles. It began in his hands. He then felt it in his calves. Next, his arms thinned a bit. He mentioned his condition to my brother-in-law, who was a physician. My brother-in-law, alarmed, sent him to a specialist. The specialist conducted a lengthy battery of tests, blood, neurological, and muscular, and he reached his conclusion: Lou Gehrig's disease, a devastating crippler. No one knows the cause or the cure. The only sure thing about it is its cruelty and accuracy. I looked down at the plot of ground that would someday entomb my father. Daddy always wanted to be buried under an oak tree, so he bought this one. Special order from the valley, he had boasted. Had to get special permission from the city council to put it here. That wasn't hard in this dusty oil field town where everybody knows everybody. The lump got tighter in my throat. A lesser man might have been angry. Another man might have given up. But Daddy didn't. He knew that his days were numbered, so he began to get his house in order. The tree was only one of the preparations he made. He improved the house for Mom by installing a sprinkler system and a garage door opener, and by painting the trim. He got the will updated. He verified the insurance and retirement policies. He bought some stock to go toward his grandchildren's education. He planned his funeral. He bought cemetery plots for himself and Mom. He prepared his kids through words of assurance and letters of love. And last of all, he bought the tree. A live oak tree, pronounced with an accent on live. Final acts, final hours, final words. They reflect a life well lived. So do the last words of our Master. When on the edge of death, Jesus too got his house in order. A final prayer of forgiveness, a plea honored, a request of love, a question of suffering, a confession of humanity, a call of deliverance, a cry of completion. Words of chance muttered by a desperate martyr? No, words of intent painted by the divine deliverer on the canvas of sacrifice. Final words, final acts. Each one is a window through which the cross can be better understood. Each one opens a treasury of promises. So that is where you learned it, I said aloud as though speaking to my father. I smiled to myself and thought, it's much easier to die like Jesus if you have lived like him for a lifetime. The final hours are passing now. The gentle flame on his candle grows weaker and weaker. He lies in peace, his body dying, his spirit living. No longer can he get out of bed. He has chosen to live his last days at home. It won't be long. Death's windy draft will soon exhaust the flickering candle, and it will be over. I looked one last time at the slender oak. I touched it as if it had been hearing my thoughts. Grow, I whispered. Grow strong. Stand tall. Yours is a valued treasure. As I drove home through the ragged oil field patchwork, I kept thinking about that tree. Though feeble, the decades will find it strong. Though slender, the years will add thickness and strength. Its last years will be its best, just like my father's, just like my master's. It is much easier to die like Jesus if you have lived like him for a lifetime. Grow, young tree. My eyes were misting. Stand strong. Yours is a valued treasure. He was awake when I got home. I leaned over his bed. I checked on the tree, I told him. It's growing. He smiled. Chapter 2. Words That Wound. Father, forgive them. Luke 23:34. The dialogue that Friday morning was bitter. From the onlookers, come down from the cross if you are the Son of God. From the religious leaders, he saved others, but he can't save himself. From the soldiers, if you are the King of the Jews, save yourself. Bitter words. Acidic with sarcasm. Hateful. Irreverent. Wasn't it enough that he was being crucified? Wasn't it enough that he was being shamed as a criminal? Were the nails insufficient? Was the crown of thorns too soft? Had the flogging been too short? For some, apparently so. Peter, a writer not normally given to using many descriptive verbs, says that the passers-by hurled insults at the crucified Christ. They didn't just yell or speak or scream. They hurled verbal stones. They had every intention of hurting and bruising.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.